Okay, we are going to see a few exercises about the break statement. Okay, so let's see this one. We have a Python code. Well, do you see any syntax error in this program? Take a look. I don't really see there's anything particularly wrong in the syntax. Well, and the next question is, well, what will this program produce? What will be the output? Okay, if we want to read this code together, we created a variable called number, and the initial value is 0, and then we say for number in the range 10, and then in the body of the for loop we do a break and then we print the number. So what is going to be the expected output? The answer is nothing. So why? Well, the reason is, well, when we start the first round, very, very first round of iteration, and then number will be 0, right? And then the first thing we enter the first round of iteration is a break. What does a break mean? The break means, I'm gonna finish running the entire iteration. So at the very beginning of the first round, we have already say we quit. And then this line of the code will never get a chance to trigger, so we got nothing printed. Well, does this program has any syntax error? The answer is no, but the problem is at the break. Well, because this break is not wrapped in a if-else condition, so this break is going to be triggered unconditionally. So, well, we are always going to get this break triggered in the first round, and that's a problem. Okay, let's see a second example. So we started another number equals 0, and then we have a for loop, and then if the number is a 5, we do a break, and then outside the if, and we print the number is, and then we put the number, and we eventually we do out of loop. Okay, so what will be the expected output for this one? So we started at 0, and then we can print the number is 0, and then we print the number is 1, number is 2, number is 3, number is 4. But when we have the number to be a 5, we check this condition, that is a 5, and then we finish running the entire iteration. And after we finish running the entire iteration, where do we go? We go here, right? And then we are going to print out of loop. Okay, so for this out of loop, it can be printed. Why? Because that is indeed out of the definition of a for loop. It doesn't belong to the body of the iteration. It doesn't belong to the else either. Right, so this line, the last line, is really out of the definition of the for loop, so the last line out of loop will still be printed. Okay, and well, let's talk about more use cases of the break. Well, the break is usually used in a scenario called one fails, all fail. Okay, so for example, we are checking multiple conditions. If one condition fails and then the entire product fails, what does this mean? Say I have condition 1 to condition 10. If the condition 1 is okay, but the condition 2 fails, and then there's no point to check the condition 3, condition 4, condition 5, all the way to condition 10. As long as one fails and then all fails. Okay? So, well, let me give you a use case. Like, how do we find or validate a number is a prime number? So, by the definition, a prime number is a natural number and it should be greater than 1 and has no po positive divisors other than 1 and itself. So, for example, 7. Okay, well, for the 7, between 1 and 7, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, for those numbers, can any of those numbers be evenly divisible by 7? The answer is no, right? Well, 7 well can't be evenly divisible by 2, 3, 4, 5. No way. So, well, we can say 7 is a prime number. And how about 12? So for 12, well, and the goal is still between 1 and 12. We want to find a number. Well, and this number is evenly divisible by 12. As long as we find one of this number, and then we can say, 12 is not a prime number. For example, if you find 2, and you can say, okay, 2 is a number between 1 and 12, and it is evenly divisible. 12 is evenly divisible by 2, and then it fails. Or you find 3, you find 4, you find 6, that's okay. But the point is, as long as you find one number, well, and then you can already prove 12 is not a prime number, and that's good enough. You don't have to find more than that, okay? Well, and then, well, our goal is we want to find all the prime numbers between 10 and 20, okay? Including 10, including 20. And if that is not a prime number, and then we want to say, okay, 10, for example, 10 equals 5 multiplied by 2, and then we can say, okay, 10 is a product of two numbers between 1 and 10 itself. So 10 is not a prime number. Otherwise, well, we say that is indeed a prime number. Okay, so the process is, if we want to prove that it's prime number, we have to prove that, well, there's no other divisor other than 1 and itself. Otherwise, as long as we find one more divisor between 1 and itself, we say, that's not a prime number. Okay? So let's see. Well, let's use 7, for example. And for the 7, we want to test all the numbers between 2, between 1 and itself. So we start from the 2 and we end on 6. Okay, and how do we validate that? We have to try all the numbers between 2 to 6. And we want to prove that none of the values between 2 and 6 are divisors of 7. And so the condition is, as long as I, well, number is evenly divisible by I, and then we find a problem. And then I'm going to find the I and j is the number divided by I, and then I say, well, this number I, well, this number is the product of I and j. And then we do a break, because there's no point to continue the checking. However, but I do, if I manage to finish visiting all the numbers between 2 and 6, and none of them are divisors of 7, what does that mean? That means 7 is indeed a prime number, right? So, well, I can tell 7 is a prime number if and only if I have tested all the numbers between 2 and 6. However, I can say 7 is not a prime number as long as I find one pair of I and J. As long as I find one I value, and that I value is a divisor of 7, and I can say, okay, it's not a prime number, and I'm not continuing this check. As long as I find one of the I value, and that's a divisor, and I can say, okay, no, 7 is not a prime number. But for this one, we can indeed finish all the numbers between 2 and 6, and then we will go here and say 7 is a prime number. Okay, so this is a program checking 7 to be a prime number or not. Okay, and if you want to go back, well, our goal is we want to check all the numbers between 10 to 20. And just now, we have the code which can check one value, and we use 7 as example. So my next question is, given what we have for now, how do we check all the values between 10 and 20? And actually, that's super easy. Why? Because we have already found the code to check one value. Now I want to iterate between 10 to 20. That's it. So what I did was I simply add a outer iteration from 10 to 20, and inside nothing is changed. Okay, I'm just running this code for 10 times, using this code as the body of the iteration, and that's it. Well, this is a trick sometimes I want to do, especially I'm writing a complicated iteration. I write the body first, and then I just add the outer iteration, and then I can iterate the code for whatever times I need to do. Okay? So to summarize, today we talk about the difference between the definite and indefinite loops, and usually the goal of some is, use for loop for definite loops, use while for indefinite loops. But remember, you can also use a while loop to handle the definite loops. Okay, and the next thing we talk about is a break. So break means that we want to terminate the entire iteration execution as long as we see something we don't want to see. Well, this means we can add another exit to the iteration. Well, there are built-in iterations in the for loop and in the while loop. For example, in the for loop, the built-in exit is when we finish visiting everything one by one, we finish the iteration. But in the body, you want to add another condition. When this condition is triggered, you also want to finish that the entire iteration. That's the break. Okay, and the next lecture, we are going to talk about the continue statement. And I will have one more video talking about the exercises. And see you in the next video.